Okay, so our third set of lectures for this week is by Stefano Ruffo on statistical mechanics of long range interacting systems. So we'll have three lectures by him and then two on quantum stuff by Niccolò Tifano. So you can start, Stefano.
Thank you, Abhishek. Thank you for the invitation and the opportunity to give this set of three lectures. Unfortunately, I cannot be with you, but I hope in the future that I will visit your center. So the task that I have given to me is a sort of giving a very broad introduction to the concepts features of associated with system with long range interactions, starting with the systems at the classical statistical mechanics level, and also discussing some of the dynamical properties of systems with long range interactions. Being aware that there is a very interesting recent development of these concepts in the field of quantum mechanics, especially in the field of atoms in cavity or ions in cavity and so on, I have asked a previous PhD advisor of mine, Niccolò Tifano, who is now at ETH Zurich, who is more centered around these topics. And by the way, we recently wrote together a review article that is available on the archive. So I think that he is the most appropriate person to speak about this, because my perspective in this field is a more long time perspective, and I might have not followed with care what has happened more recently. So the last two lectures will be given by him. So, more or less, the three lectures, just to give you an overview. Problem is to change. Let me try to share again. Yes, okay. It always happens with the Zoom that in the beginning you have problems. So in the first lecture, I will define what I will give some definitions, because not all definitions of long range interactions agree, and I will discuss quite at length the question of the extensivity, so the way energies scale with the sides, and the question of additivity, which in the foundations of statistical mechanics, they were not very clearly defined. And I think it's very important to keep these two concepts separated, because they have different types of consequences in the case of long range interactions. And then I will discuss also issues related with convexity of the several of the quantities that I will discuss, so convexity of free energies, convexities of entropies, especially because, and also convexity of the region of accessible states at the thermodynamic limit, because they are associated with sort of an extension of the standard Legendre type of approach that we have to statistical mechanics. In fact, they will refer much more appropriately to an extension of the Legendre transform in the direction of a non-convex function, which the mathematician prefer to call the Legendre Fenchel transform. Is a second concept of a Legendre Fenchel transform, which is more appropriate context to describe ensemble inequivalence. So in order to give a reference for these, since I'm not a mathematician, as everybody maybe knows in the hall, so I think that the best reference is to the review article by Gotuchet that describes also some of the features of the systems with long range interaction, and in particular one of his papers that I have sent as a reference to my lecture course, which is published in 2015 in JSTAT FIS. As you have seen, most of my references are date quite back in the time. And you may find that my lecture course is not very up to date, but I think that it's necessary from time to time that people like me who are in the field since a long time speak to even a younger audience because of the perspective they can give in maybe in problems that were perhaps not clearly formulated when we started to work in this field, and they should in fact be better formulated, and also there are problems that remain open, and this is and there are even tough problems that remain open, so it's very important that people in the youngest people in the audience might be active also in trying to solve some of the. I try some of these problems, and I will try to pinpoint to emphasize those problems. So also for the sake of the younger audience, I will start with a sort of a historical. Introduction. I'm old enough to speak about history. So, because my engagement in this field started long, long ago, and it might be interesting to know how, by some curiosities, I was driven to study problems related to long-range interactions and what are the types of issues that were not clear at the time and that brought me far away from the right approach for a long time. So essentially I started to, so I will devote to these 10 minutes. I don't want to annoy you with this type of recollections. But so I will leave myself to 10 minutes. I have my clock in front of me. So when I started to work on long range interactions, I was visiting a group of plasma physics in Marseille, a very good group led by Dominique Escant, a good friend of mine who was for some time also director of the Cadarache Center of Fusion in France. And I was interested in an approach that he had studying plasmas, not using continuum equations, but using models of waves and particles. So essentially his idea was that the plasma is finally a discrete object made of charges, made of waves. So, and he didn't like the approach typically used of, which is more a fluid dynamical approach, more continuum approach. So that's why he invited me, because he wanted to know from me, what are phase transitions? Are we statistical physicists treat problems with many particles and how we deal with phase transitions? So then it started a very interesting period that lasted a couple of years from 1991 to 1993, in which I was trying to use the tools of statistical mechanics to understand these very complicated Hamiltonians arising from plasma physics. You can look at the book by Dominique, which is very, very nice book, Microscopic Theory of Plasma, is, I think, is the title, where you will meet some of the Hamiltonians that I was trying to Hamiltonian system that I was trying to understand at the time. And then at the end of this period, I arrived with a solution, partial solution, which was led me to introduce a model, which is nowadays called the Hamiltonian mean field model, which is essentially a model of particles without waves. Although in the beginning, I was trying also to study system with waves, which has a second order phase transitions and where you can study dynamics and where you can study the ensembles, canonical, microcanonical, and so on. And then I realized that this model didn't have a solution in the microcanonical ensemble. And in fact, I like to do a quote from the book of Huang. So it says, there seems little hope that we can straightforwardly carry out the recipe for the microcanonical ensemble for any system but the ideal gas. This is from the last edition of Wang. And since I had studied statistical physics on the Wang, I suppose many of you have looked in this book, I was very disappointed to know from him, which for me was an example and a star in the field, to know that he was very, very negative about getting the solution in the microcanonical ensemble. So I essentially stopped looking into the microcanonical of this model, and I derived some results in the canonical ensemble, but it remained a mystery. And the mystery was about the fact that if I was drawing numerically what at that time were called the caloric curves, so the relation, what you typically don't do in statistical mechanics is usually you try to compute, let's say, the order parameters, and you are not really interested in the relation between energy and temperature, because you know that, after all, it's a very trivial relation in the canonical ensemble. It's a derivative with respect to the inverse temperature of the inverse temperature times the free energy. So what is the mystery in this? But at that time, there was also interest in the field of so-called small system, especially people working in atomic collisions. I remember Dieter Gross, who died, unfortunately, meanwhile. And it was clear that working, getting some results for systems that were finite and were closed, so not interacting with the environment, was very interesting to do. But unfortunately, as one was stating in this citation, was not very easy to get a solution in the microcanonical ensemble. So of this model, so we sort of, I will speak about this model in the third of my lecture. So then I was essentially proceeding numerically, and the numerics was very shocking for me, because drawing the curve of the temperature versus the energy in this model, I found regions of the energy where the temperature was decreasing with energy. So I remember very well that I started to look for mistakes in the program, what wrong I did with my program that was not getting the right things. So then I traveled to a conference. That's also, that's an interesting thing for the younger people, that you should travel not only to the conference in your field, but sometimes on a while you should travel to conferences, now that travel is possible. Once more, to travel to conferences that are not in your field. So it was a conference, very broad one, and I could meet a theoretical astrophysicists. So then those guys were very far from my culture, but a few of them, by the way, some of them that I then involved in the project that I had died one very important person that I would like to remember, since we are in India with is now I have to look in the Zush book, because I let me see, I now his name evaporates from my head, but it's Tanu Padmanabhan, who died unfortunately very very young, and a very strong interest in the statistical mechanics of self-gravitating systems. And so he explained to me that negative specific heat is quite common if the interactions are long range. So now I'm on the sixth minute, so I should stop history. But this essentially led me in the following 5-6 years, until with David Mukamel, we did what I consider the foundational paper in this field. We did our study of the Elsamborine equivalence in the Blume-Capella mean field model, which I will treat in the lecture of tomorrow. But at the beginning was not very clear where to find the Elsamborine equivalence, and then it became clear that it should be found in systems that perform a first order phase transition, while the HMF model was performing a second order phase transition. So we were directed towards situations where metal stability could appear, or instability could appear in the, and so the field of first order phase transition. But of course, this does not exclude that Elsamborine equivalence realizes also around the second order phase transition. And I don't know if I will have the time to deal with this problem, but you will find it maybe in my review and also in my book. But there is a very famous model by Thieringa that that was in fact also a paper that I read later. Where there is a very interesting feature of inequivalence of ensembles, which has to do with the location of the second order phase transition point. So in fact, the situation is more intricate, but I would say that it's very important that you first understand that this feature of long-range interactions appears because the transitions are first order. Okay, so let's stop here my sort of brief historical introduction. And so that essentially contains the first 10 years of my activity in this field. And then the activity that started after this foundational paper with David Mukamel in 2001, published in PRL. I gave the reference in the list of references. Then in the next 15 years of activities in this field, before going to quantum, I essentially worked on extending the study of different situations, and also studying the issue of dynamics, because in fact, in the beginning, the feature of the problems that I was studying was very much related with dynamics. So I started, I was in the different years, very much interested also in the dynamical evolution of the, I'm sure that Abhishek will like this part, having worked a lot on non-equilibrium. And I think that there are still issues in long-range interacting systems that are interesting to study, even in classical systems or oscillators. Okay, so let's start with after this 20 minutes introduction plus historical discussion. Let us start with the definitions. So suppose you have a I mean, essentially speak here of a system of particles, but you will see that you can extend it also to lattice systems once you consider systems that are have dynamic hard variables defined at the site of a lattice. But let's talk about broadly about system of particles. So suppose I have a system of particles. They are defined, the location is defined on the continuum, and then there is an interaction potential which decays at large distance with a certain power alpha. So it doesn't decay exponentially. So it decays faster than exponential, let's say, at large distances. Okay, so there are many of such interactions in nature. You can think of start beginning with the Lennard-Jones interaction, which is r to the minus 6, and then the dipolar interaction, which is r to the minus 3, and then there's a Coulomb interaction and also the gravitational interactions r to the minus 1. Okay, so let us use the broad definition of to call long range an interaction for which the decaying exponent is limited between zero and D, including both zero and D, the dimension of the space where you define your particles. So I will tell you why in a second, why I use this definition of long-range interaction. It has to do with the finiteness or non-finiteness of the energy per particle. So you can see that the two limiting situations, the one where the decay is a dimension of the space, which is a dipolar interaction, and the one where the exponent is zero, which is in some sense an interaction that does not decay with space, which is, if you want, is the mean field interaction, so in which all particles interact with all other particles, are included into this set of considered exponents, but they are in some sense special. I will not have time to enter in the reason why they are special, okay? For instance, the limit of mean field alpha going to zero might be singular. So that we have indications that what happens very close to zero is not exactly what happens when alpha is exactly zero. So when you have done the limit. And also, on the other hand, on the hand of the dipolar interaction, it's yet unclear whether there might be features like ensembling equivalence that are more related to the additivity, because this is a limiting situation in which the system is almost additive. As you well know from the theory of the dipolar interaction, which has been studied in the theoretically and mathematically in famous paper by Griffiths and also by Lieb, the dipoles tend to form domains, and these domains might break the sample magnetization and lead to effects that are due to the volume but are not related directly with the non-additivity. So it's a really an interesting but hard system to look in. So the most simple thing that you can do, given a system of particles that interact with the potential V of R, is to try to compute the energy contained in a ball in which you exclude the inner part, the smaller the part near the origin, in order to avoid, for instance, gravitational divergences or Coulomb divergences. So in this integral that I'm trying to estimate the energy of a sample, I perform an integration from the lower value delta, which is non-zero, and then the ball has radius d. Supposing now that matter is homogeneously distributed with a density rho, it might be even charge density or not or only mass density. Then the integral to perform is the integral in ddr of rho times the interaction size, which is j, divided by r to the alpha. This integral is very easy to perform at a constant density and gives the result that you see to the right. So to the right, you can see that it is proportional to the density, of course, to the coupling, and that there are essentially two contributions that come dimensionally from the fact that the dimensionally the integral goes like t minus alpha, no? You can see. So it's r, the radius of the ball to the d minus alpha minus the radius of the inner region that I exclude because I would like to avoid problems appearing at short distances. And I take a difference of the two, and this gives you an estimate of this. So then you can clearly see that if alpha is larger than d, then if you take the limit r goes to infinity by taking delta constant, then you get a finite energy density. You know, if alpha is bigger than d, the dependence on r will disappear, only the dependence on delta that we will keep finitely non-zero. And you get an estimate of the energy contained in a ball. It's very important to remark that besides getting an energy that is constant in a ball, you also obtain the fact that this integral no more depends on the boundary r, on the radius of the ball. This is important to make this remark because another feature of long-range interaction is due to the fact that the effect of the boundary conditions are at some point is negligible. So there are important effects that are due to boundary conditions, but in equilibrium you can expect that irrespective of the type of boundary condition that you should do statistical mechanics irrespective of the type of boundary conditions. While in long range interactions, so if alpha in the second line is less than d, then a dependence on the upper radius of the ball remains. And if you write the energy density as a function of the volume, which essentially r to the d, you can see that the energy density scales with an exponent, which is 1 minus alpha over d. So the energy is super extensive. The energy is super extensive in the volume if alpha is less than d, and it does depend on the volume. Okay, so what can we do then if energy depends on the volume? Of course, this is not acceptable for performing a bona fide thermodynamic limit because we would like to increase the volume to infinite, increasing the number of particles and keeping the energy density constant. This is what we would like to do. But apparently, because of this property, which is very simple to obtain, then of course you can think of counterexamples, but this is what generically happens in systems with long range interactions. So what can you do? Now, if you open a book of statistical mechanics, even the Wang book, which was very pessimistic about the microcanonical ensemble, but already encountered one example that enters in this class, which is the Curie-Weiss model. And the solution is already pointed out in the chapter of the one book devoted to the Curie-Weiss model. It will be an exercise at the end of this lecture. And what is the recipe that you find there? without any sort of explanation, you will find in the book that you have to divide the coupling constant that I've called J, remembering the superposition of orbitals of spins that are important in magnetism. So you will have to divide the coupling constant by the size of the system. This is a sort of unexplained, reasonable, nevertheless, because the idea of Curie-Weiss is that, in fact, what a single spin will feel is not the fluctuating mean field, the fluctuating mean field that is more realistic, but a sort of average mean field, which is the same for all spins. And so the typical interaction is the mean field times the spin. And it's very natural then to sum over the spins and to obtain a 1 over n in front of the coupling. This, of course, has been formalized also by mathematicians, and in the 60s, one can remember famous work of Berlin, Katz, Thomson, and others, Leibovitz and others, where people understood that if you solve the Curie-Weiss model on a fully coupled network, you get an exact solution. But how to extend this recipe to systems for which the interaction does decay with space? So it's not all to all. So the recipe, in fact, is very simple and was pointed out by Katz. I never found, in fact, a single paper where Katz put it exactly in this way. But one can, I think, reasonably extrapolate that he had this in mind, that you should multiply the scale, the constant, the coupling constant, by a volume-dependent term, which is proportional exactly to the wrong scaling of the energy density in order to compensate the wrong scaling of the energy density by multiplying the coupling constant times V to the alpha over D minus one. Now, as a consequence of this scaling of the coupling, one gets a free energy, which and an entropy also. An entropy is already, I didn't comment about the entropy, but one gets a finite temperature, one gets a free energy that scales with the volume. This is so-called, I called it Katz rescaling or Katz trick, and nowadays this type of rescaling is, although in the beginning people working on quantum system were avoiding to do this type of rescaling because after all they were working with the finite systems of atoms in a finite volume, so that they were not really interested in performing the thermodynamic limit. But nowadays they tend to use this Katz rescaling, and you will hear also in the lectures of Nicolò how useful can be this Katz rescaling, even for finite systems, because it simplifies all the scaling properties when you vary the size of the system, when you increase the number of atoms, and when you increase the volume. Okay, alternatively.
Stefano, one question. So is this scaling of entropy with volume, is that obvious or like?
Okay, so I will keep the obvious side of the attitude. So I consider entropy in a combinatorial quantity, which is not affected by the type of interaction that you choose, so more in the Boltzmann style, so that you are sort of ignorant about the information contained in the system. And so the scaling of the entropy is somewhat induced only by the fact that you are trying to understand combinatorially what is the volume of the system. Of course, the scaling may change If you are close to critical points, it's very well known, for instance, that the scaling can be very tricky near critical points, but I will exclude for the moment discussion of critical points. Of course, yes, they would definitely need a more careful discussion of in case you want to understand the scaling of entropy. And also, if you want to understand the scaling of entropy in more complex objects, like, for instance, black holes or other types of systems that might be interesting to study thermodynamically. So I will definitely not discuss in the first lectures different scalings of this type, but they exist, and you are right, Abhishek, to point out that one should more broadly consider the possibility of different types of scalings for the entropy. In all the examples that I will discuss that already contain ensemble inequivalence and phase diagram with ensemble inequivalence, I do not need to modify the scaling of the entropy. The entropy is left to the usual scaling with the volume. Okay, so alternatively, and this is an approach that was in fact followed by Turing. The model of Turing, I don't know if I will have time. We have only three lectures, so I cannot cover all of the models that I have been studying in these 30 years. But the model of Turing is very simple, and indeed this paper was a really foundational paper. So Turing was the first to understand, Walter Turing from Vienna, from Wien, where I'm now in the harbor of the Austrian-Hungarian Empire, Trieste, so I should pay respect to Vienna. So Turing, in this couple of papers in the 70s, I think 69 and 70, introduced a very simple model that was mimicking gravitational interaction. The idea was to take at particles that are free to move in a given volume, and then they interact only if they are within a volume, a smaller volume that is contained in this much bigger volume. It is apparently a very, very, very simple system, but it's possible very easily to do an estimate of the entropy and also to solve the model in the microcanonical ensemble, opposite to what Wang thinks, and get ensemble inequivalence in a very straightforward way. In his model, Turing does not use the CAT scaling. So he renounces to use the CAT scaling. As a side effect of renouncing to use the CAT scaling, he obtained a temperature which scales with the volume. So a temperature which is non-intensive. And in fact, the typical setting in which his model is solved exactly is the one where the temperature scales with the volume to the 1 minus alpha over d, so it's growing with the size of the system, so the temperature is increasing with the size of the system, and so as a consequence of that, you should be careful in scaling properly the free energy, which in fact, the free energy in that case scales with the volume to 2 minus alpha over. So if you are careful enough to divide the free energy by that quantity instead of dividing by the volume, everything works fine. The only problem is that you get very, very large temperature. So once in a calculation done by David Mucamela, he did a very simple calculation. He was trying to estimate this temperature for a globular cluster. So a cluster that there are many of such objects in our galaxies. These are stars that presumably have reached a sort of equilibrium configuration. And it turns out that the temperature of this system is, of course, enormous. So something like 10 to the 70 Kelvin. It's a ridiculously large temperature. But if you then derive from this temperature the average velocity of each of the stars, it's not very far from the velocity that you observe in gravitational observations. So after all, the idea of Keating was not very pleasant to estimate, to use scaling in temperature rather than to use. In fact, I should change this transparency. It's an old transparent slide, and I should add the name of Keating to the second scaling, because it's really the one, the person that introduced this type of different scales. Okay, all that has to do with extensivity. So how quantities behave with increasing the volume or the number of parts. Now let us come to the issue of additivity. So the second issue that I promised to you to deal with. So as you have seen, I'm keeping the discussion at the very elementary level, and I think it's I don't know if you are bored about this very elementary level, but I think also being far away, it's better than being too technical, I think, to just stay at a very elementary level. So this is an example that is the simplest I could conceive of a system that violates additivity, although it is perfectly extensive. And this system is the one that also I will invite you to solve in the today in the tutorial, a very simple exercise, is the Curie-Weiss model, the Curie-Weiss Hamiltonian, where, as you can see, the Hamiltonian is minus J over twice the number of particles or spins, and all the spins are coupled to each other. So you find this model in the, of course, in the book, in any book of statistical mechanics, including the one book. It's the most simple model of magnetism, and you can think of sigma I as classical spins that whose value is either plus one or minus one. Now, as you can see, the energy of the model is perfectly extensive. So the sum goes like n squared. If you divide the sum that goes like n squared, you divide by n, the energy grows like n. But it's very simple to conclude with very simple calculation that the model is non-additive. What does it mean? It means that if I take the sample and I divide this sample of n of such spins in two parts, now be aware that being this system essentially in this system, essentially, space is absent, so there is no space. All spins interact with all other spins. The way in which I divide the sample has nothing to do with cutting the volume, because the volume is not there. So I simply group the spins in one group, let's say group one, and another group of spin, group two. Okay. Now, let us take a very special state, but I assure you that if you repeat the calculation for any other state, you will find the same result. It has been done also in some papers, not only with the Curie-Weiss, but also with the model where the interactions decay in space, which is more realistic. Let's take, for instance, the zero magnetization state. It's a state in which the magnetization is globally zero. So what does it mean? It means that half of the spins are plus and half of the spins are minus. Now you can easily see that in this model is sort of degenerate, because the energy is proportional to the magnetization square. So once you fix the magnetization, you also fix the energy. Don't worry, there is no consequences of this. You will see that there will be consequences from ensemble inequivalence. In fact, the reason why, after all, it's not important to solve this model in the microcanonical ensemble, which is possible, because the two ensembles for this model are equivalent. Remind that the Curie-Weiss Hamiltonian has a second order presupposition. So As I told you in the introductory notes, you should not be worried about ensemble equivalence for such a model, unless you add the magnetic field. So this model would require a more careful discussion in presence of a magnetic field. In fact, some of the response function associated in this case with susceptibility would create problems when comparing different ensembles. But I will not discuss this. This issue is discussed in a paper that I wrote with Hugo Touchet some time ago, where I discussed the negativity of the possible negativity of susceptibility in the Curie-Weiss setting and also in the more broader setting. So now let us compute the energy of the total, so the energy of the system containing both the plus spins and the minus spins. And of course, since the magnetization is zero globally, the energy will be zero. So the energy of the system of pluses and minuses. While if you compute the energies of each of the two parts, they are of course non-zero. They are negative, okay? They are negative and proportional to n. Sorry, you might be induced to think that j over 8 is also n is in the numerator. Okay, the energy is proportional to n and its value is minus j over 8. So the energy of the total is not the sum of the energies of the parts. And there is an extra energy which is related with the interactions among part one and part two, which is of the same order of the energy of part one and part two. Because in order to cope with the fact that the sum is non-zero and the sum is proportional to n, you should add an interaction energy which is of the same order, or order n. So it means that the surface energy, the one that in a system with short range interaction will be limited to the interface between the cluster of pluses and the cluster of minuses, here is a scaling with the size of the system. And I can assure you, by the way, if there are people interested in doing the calculation, I can point out to the papers where the calculation is done, that if you take an interaction that decays with space, for instance, you modify the Curie-Weiss Hamiltonian and you take a coupling which decays with the distance with a power alpha that is less, let's say, in one dimension than one, the contribution of the surface energy can be computed and be shown to contribute extensively to in the thermodynamic limit if alpha is bigger, is smaller than one in one dimension, and of course smaller than d in the dimensions. Okay, so you can see a feature which is interesting of lack of additivity. Now, I believe that this is an essential feature for ensemble inequivalence. So the essential constituent of the reason why a system in equilibrium does not have ensemble equivalence is because of this lack of additivity. So this is a basic hypothesis that you do in every book of statistical mechanics in the first pages. When you recall thermodynamics, you recall the fact that the energy should be an additive quantity. Magnetization should be an additive quantity, and so on. And in this case, it's not true. So there's the Curie-Weiss model is not true. It's very curious that you put the Curie-Weiss model as an example of magnetism in any bona fide book of equilibrium statistical mechanics, and students should be informed about this fact. I think that the reason why, after all, everything goes fine with the Curie-Weiss model is that there is a second order phase transition and the ensembles are equivalent. So you don't really have consequences of this non-additivity. But for instance, if you would add to the list of examples the three states Minfield-Potts model, you will run into very big problems with ensemble equivalence, and if you want, of course, to deal with the microcanonical ensemble. Another feature that you will see in the lecture of tomorrow, and I won't like to anticipate it qualitatively, is what happens with the states that are accessible in the thermodynamic limit for a system with long-range interactions. I here draw a plane with two axes. In one axis, I put the extensive magnetization M, the total magnetization, and in the other axis, I put the energy. Now, then I put myself the following question. What is the line, the shape of the line, or the shape of the region, if you want, that contains the equilibrium states of a model with short range interactions? And the conclusion, which is very easy to find, although I must say, okay, we need some more mathematical accuracy, is that for instance, imagine a spin system, the region of states that the system occupies in equilibrium in the thermodynamic limit is a convex region. While for systems in long-range interactions, because of the lack of additivity, you can find that the region of accessible states is non-convex. It has, for instance, the form of a bean here, since in Italy we are close to lunchtime, this sort of bean shape. Why that? Because you cannot exclude that because of the lack of additivity, you cannot really construct all the states that connect a state with magnetization M1 and an energy E1 with a state with magnetization M2 and energy E2. In this case, I have two conserved quantities, magnetization and energy. Because in the short range system, it's very easy to construct all the systems that lie along this line. You simply take a certain fraction, as I show in the following slide, certain fraction of system with energy E1 and energy E2, and a certain fraction of system with magnetization M1 and magnetization M2, maybe with different ratios, and it's very simple to build all states with energy E and energy M once you do this construction, since the surface interaction energy is negligible in the thermodynamic limit. But this is not true for systems with long-range interaction. So suppose you are, for instance, on the energy shell. You are in the microcanonical ensemble. So you are at fixed energy. Now, if there are no states here in the concave region that fill the space of accessible state, and I will show an example maybe already tomorrow in a model that was introduced by Kardar and Nagel in the 70s in the canonical ensemble, where in fact there are no such state here. So if I want to go from a state with the magnetization M1 to a state with the magnetization M2, I should jump in some way, so I should invent a dynamics which is non-local, so that changes the spin in a non-local way. Because if I follow the dynamics by changing step by step the magnetization, I will hit to this barrier and I will be unable to go to the other part of the phase space. So we can expect that systems with long-range interactions, and there are several examples, both spin system and system of particles, show in a very generic way broken ergodicity. So on the energy shell, the system can be divided into two parts. One part where the magnetization is on average close to M1, and another part where the magnetization is on average close to M2. This is not only expected, but we have also plenty of examples that this happens in systems with long range interaction. Of course, I do not say that this does not happen in systems with short range interactions, because the reasoning was very simple, but I claim that the case is more generic when the interactions are long range. Okay, so we are now more or less 1 hour since the start of my lecture, but I will go on. I hope that you are not too tired. I will stop for 1 minute to ask if there are questions on this first part.
So this non-convexity that you were talking in the previous slide.
Yes.
Happens for a nearest neighbor Ising model, right?
Does not happen for nearest neighbor Ising models. No. The if you, for instance, if you try, I never did the exercise. By the way, I proposed to do it to I gave the same lecture course at ICTP a few months ago. So suppose I take a Monte Carlo, it would be very interesting to do it because I didn't find in the literature. Suppose you do a Monte Carlo of a two-dimensional Ising model, okay? And now you try to sample microcanonical Monte Carlo, of course, okay? So it's possible to do Kreutz algorithm, okay? Or even you could take, I don't know, Phi-4 theory and do molecular dynamics. You can do so, conserve energy evolution. Now you start by increasing the size of the system, and you sample the energy and the magnetization. It can be done. It's easy to do. No, you fix the energy, then you select the energy by the temperature, for instance, by running first canonical code, Metropolis Monte Carlo code, and then you get energy and then magnetization, okay? And then you put a point in this plot if you get the energy. What can you expect? Of course, there will not be energies above a given value because the energies are typically negative, no? Because the interaction is ferromagnetic. And there will be less and less states as you go to lower and lower energies, no? Until you are at zero and at the ground state where you have only two energies, no? The energy associated, where you have only two magnetization. So the energy, all the spins point into one direction, all the spin point into another. But except for that specific case where you are at the ground state, as soon as you raise the energy above the ground state, you will feel all the magnetization of states. They will be very rare, but there will be states as soon as you switch on, it will be hard to find, I recognize numerically, but I suspect that someone should do the exercise and see what happens. And then as you go up in energy, so you go above the ground state, of course, the number of energies that are compatible, sorry, the number of magnetization states that are compatible with a given energy will reduce until you reach a top energy in which you will have only the zero magnetization state, you know, which is the ferromagnetic region, then you have up. So what I think, and I might even have seen this graph in a paper. So I think that the shape of this region for the two-dimensional Ising model will be a sort of dome like this, no? And then you go down to the to the ground state energy, and at the ground state energy you have only two states, magnetization plus and minus one, but as soon as you raise the energy, you will feel all this storm. Now, what happens in the Kardar-Negel model, and I will show you tomorrow, is that because of the non-additivity of the model, in the mean field case, but also for short range, for the long range case, if you are close to the ground state, there will be gaps. So there will be regions in which you can prove that there are no states. While if you go up, up and up in energy, the gaps will disappear. It will be more natural to find states in a given region around some magnetization state. But unfortunately, I've never seen this type of graph for the two-dimensional Ising model. And I'm not a numerical guy. Moreover, I don't think it's an easy exercise, but it's certainly, it would be certainly interesting to try this sort of exercise. So there are other questions?
Yes, this non-additivity, which leads to this basically non-convexity, I understood for the example you showed, but is there any way to understand that it is a general property of these long-range interactions?
What I claim, okay, so it's just, there is no proof. So I don't pretend it is a proof, but it would be very natural to expect that if you have an interaction that decays, we could prove it only for mean field interactions, but if the interactions is decaying slowly, as I was telling, I expect that situations like this one can be found. That will be model dependent, of course, and so I don't claim it's general, okay, but since we found them in mean field, I expect that they could be found also for decaying interactions. For mean field, we could get proofs.
Okay, thanks.
So if there are no other questions, I would continue because I think 25 minutes till the end of the talk. I don't see how many slides I have, but okay. Okay, the type of models. So the type of models that I will discuss, they will both off and on lattice. So in on off lattice model, you have system of particles that interact with interaction potential V, and maybe with a local field like gravitational and point masses or Coulomb point charges that falls into this category. Or, and this is more interesting for the quantum case, is a system where I have a lattice. So imagine, for instance, the lattice is generated by crossing lasers where you put atoms in a cold cavity. Then the dynamical variable will be, let's say, the spin or the polarization of the single atom. Then in this case, what is long range is not the potential of interaction among the atoms, but the coupling of the spin degrees of freedom or the polarization degrees of freedom as the distance increases among the atoms that are placed on the lattice. So in both cases, one can reasonably expect, as I've shown before, that the region of long range interaction is the one between zero and D. And by the way, nowadays, in cold atoms, and this will be the subject of the talk of Nicolò, it is really possible to tune the interaction among the polarizations of the atoms in such a way that the exponents alpha spans all the region between zero and D, just by simply changing the property of the atoms that are put in the wells and of the type of fields with which the atoms interact. So it's a very interesting that nowadays we can realize in experiments type of models that are the ones that you you have in the second case. So the case in which the dynamical variable is defined on a lattice. Now, let us, for concreteness, define a model that could be considered a sort of laboratory for long-range interactions. The model was introduced by Dyson in the 60s, and I define it in one dimension. It's a one-dimensional spin one-half Ising model where the spins interact with a coupling, as I was mentioning before, which decays with the distance with an exponent alpha that I now call 1 plus sigma. I remind to you that I am in one dimension, so you can imagine a chain of spins, okay? The case of previous case of Q-revised is simply the one in which sigma is is minus one, in such the case that the interaction does not decay. While the case corresponding to the additive and correctly scaling free energies and entropies is the one where sigma is bigger than zero. Now, what was considered interesting in this type of model was that although you are in one dimension, the model clearly showed the presence of phase transitions in all the region between sigma zero and sigma equal one. By the way, the latter case, the case sigma equal one, was studied by Taules and considered as an example of the Berezinski-Kostelitz-Taules transition. I have no time to enter in this, but for instance, we are working on this with a student who is finishing his PhD and will go next year to Paris as a postdoc, Guido Giachetti, where we have some interesting results of a normalization group of this model in this limiting case of sigma equal to one. In this case, the energy will be extensive in N and no troubles will be encountered, but there is an interesting feature that maybe not everybody knows, that there are phase transitions in one dimension. Although the system is additive, in this region of sigma. So the interaction is sufficiently long range to induce phase transitions, but not sufficient to induce all the tricky properties of long range interacting systems. So what we have done some time ago with Thierry Dauxois, Freddy Boucher, and Julien Barrier, Julien at that time was my student, was to analyze the region of sigma less than zero that was not analyzed in the 60s by Dyson, Drouelle, and the others. In this case, the energy is not extensive. Since we are on a lattice, the volume is proportional to the number of sides. So the energy will scale in this case with n to the one minus sigma. So let us apply Kazeri scaling for this case. This is simply amounts to rescale the coupling constant with n to the sigma in such a way that the free energy correctly scales with the sides of the system n. So now, what were we able to prove together with Julien, Freddy, and Thierry? We were able to prove that it is possible to perform in this region of sigma a continuum limit where dividing the lattice in K boxes containing N over K, big N over big K size, and introducing a box average magnetization. This is a calculation that you can find in a paper that I don't remember if I added to the list. Maybe not. I will tell you the paper. Is a JSTAT-FIS paper of 2005. We can take the limit of N goes to infinity, K goes to infinity, with K over N, which is the inverse of the number of spins per box, going to zero, in such a way that the magnetization becomes a continuous function of X, which is a variable that is defined between zero and one. So I define my interval between zero and one, and to write the Hamiltonian as a functional of this magnetization in such a way that the energy is a double integral in dx1, in dx, dx prime, of the product of the magnetization in two different sides. Sorry, there is an x here in the place of this r, there is x, x prime. And with the distance between the box, the two boxes of magnetization at distance x. So what is the advantage of having write the problem in this form? So the energy of the Dyson model will be scaling with n times this functional plus corrections that are little o, so they are going to zero with n, n. The advantage is that I can solve a variational problem where I maximize the entropy, which will also be a function, at some given energy. Now, the entropy would require a little bit of more of discussion and would also require an introduction of the language of large deviations. But okay, I will be short in this presentation. And essentially what happens is that the entropy is a sort of Ising entropy. So you see the typical form 1 plus m log of 1 plus m, 1 minus m, 1 log of 1 minus m in each of the boxes. And the total entropy will turn out to be a product of independent local entropies to give the global entropy of this model. This, of course, deserves a proof that has been done also more rigorously by Takeshi Mori, but is contained on essentially with sort of theoretical physicist approach in the paper that we have with these three guys in JSTAT-FIS. So essentially, if you lump these entropies corresponding to each of the boxes into a product of entropies, and then you define the global entropies associated with the given magnetization profile, then you can solve a variational problem by determining the magnetization profile, which is compatible with the maximal entropy at a given energy. And what turns out to be the result of this paper is that if you work with periodic boundary conditions, this problem can be solved analytically. And what you find is that the profile of magnetization, which solves the variational problem, is the constant profile. And the value of magnetization that you get in this constant profile is exactly the magnetization of the Q-revised model. So it's the solution of the implicit equation M equal tanh of beta JM. Beta, of course, is the Lagrange multiplier associated with the energy in the energy variational problem that I have defined appropriately in this case. This profile is also shown to be stable. In which sense? In the sense that if you introduce any perturbation on this magnetization profile of any frequency, you can analyze in Fourier the perturbations, all perturbation will produce an entropy which is smaller at a given energy. So you are sure that the magnetization profile that maximizes the entropy at given energy is the one where the magnetization is constant. This is not the case if the boundary conditions are not periodic. And here in this figure, I show a simulation that we have done at that time. And it would be interesting also to find solutions for other type of boundary conditions with a free boundary condition. And you can see that the profile of magnetization between 0 and 1 is not at all constant. It depends on the energy, it depends on the coupling. Alpha here, you remember alpha is 1 plus sigma. And you can see that indeed there is a profile of magnetization that in this case. So it means that this is the richness of the Dyson model that, and I have no idea what function is this profile. It has been done numerically. This proves that the problem is quite rich and that there are profiles of magnetization maximizing entropy that are non-constant in the case of interaction decaying with power alpha or sigma, if you want. I will not enter in this discussion of this slide. Maybe I will skip to the discussion because we are towards the end of the lecture and I would like to make a brief comment about Legendre-Fenchel transform. So you will allow me to speak 5 minutes about the Legendre-Fenchel. So this is a standard type of tool that is used in thermodynamics, but not only in thermodynamics. Suppose you have entropy as a function of energy. Now, you know very well that by forming the Legendre transform, so you take the infimum over epsilon. Epsilon is the energy density, a fixed density, for instance, n. You have a system of particles in this case. Take the infimum of beta epsilon minus the entropy, and you get a free energy. Now, if the entropy is a concave function of energy, then you get a concave Massier potential, which is beta times the free energy, which is depicted in the figure above. Moreover, it is also well known that if you have the free energy instead as a function of the inverse temperature, and you perform a Legendre transform, in case in which the free energy is concave, the Massier potential is concave, you get respectively the energy. And of course, there is a nice property of the Legendre transform. Maybe in the tutorial, I would suggest some exercises on the Legendre transform in such a way that if you have the free computed instead of the free energy, you get the entropy as the Legendre transform of the free energy. After all what is in these figures and what is in these relations is finally the result of the saddle point calculation that you see sketched on the bottom of this transparency. Suppose you start with the massive potential beta f to the left of this derivation, and you take the exponential of this massive potential. This exponential at finite n can be written as the partition function at finite volume. Now, suppose you group the states in states around the given energy, okay? So I introduce a delta, then I express the delta in terms of the volume, and it's very clear that you get the first, the Jean-Penschel transform, the Jean transform that is on the line there. In the limit of n goes very large, you get the relation beta epsilon minus s of epsilon n equal to beta f. Okay. So what happens when a phase transition is of first order? So I would like to recall this, it's very simple, but good to finish a lecture, 1 hour and a half lecture with simple things, that in systems that are additive, there is a region in energy bounded by the energy epsilon one and the energy epsilon two, in which there is the entropy as a constant slope. So the entropy is no more a concave function of the energy, but there is a region of slope, of a fixed slope between the energy epsilon one and the energy epsilon two. If I do the Legendre-Fenchel transform of this, if I do the Legendre transform of this region, not yet necessary to do the Legendre-Fenchel up to this point, then I get a free energy, which is no more an analytic function of beta. There is a cusp point, and the two different slopes that you see here, the slope to the left of the point of singularity and to the right of point of singularity, they are exactly the two energies that bounds the coexistence region at the first order phase transition. Now, and I take this figure from Hugo Touchet review, Physics Reports 2009. What happens if the entropy here is not the entropy, it's minus the entropy, has a different behavior? For instance, it has a region where instead, this is minus the entropy, I'm sorry for the change in notation. So the function I is the large deviation function, which is minus the entropy. So you can imagine that I swap the figure down up. It happens the same in terms of free energy, because you have a free energy which is, in this case, convex, which is there is a minus sign, and there's a cusp point. But if you Legendre transform this free energy, you don't find the large deviation function I, but you find the convex envelope of the large deviation function. So the Legendre function, the Legendre transform, is no more invertible in the context in which entropy can have a concave. In this case, because of the change of sign, there is a little bit of confusion, but I hope it is clear that if entropy is no more a concave function of energy, what happens is that the Legendre transform is no more invertible. So it doesn't have the property that you expect from a Legendre transform. And so you should consider a broader problem in which the entropy can be non-concave. So I will maybe stop here because I have started the discussion of ensembling equivalence. Meanwhile, I will recommend in the tutorial also to try to play a little bit with the genre Fenchel transforms. I will try to give the tutorial at the blackboard in my office. I hope it's clear enough to sort of be more interactive also for questions. So, and I stop here. There are 4 minutes for questions. So I leave the floor to the audience in such a way that we can have some interaction or discussion all together.
Okay, so any questions?
I hope this figure was not very confusing, but you should simply turn the functions up down and you get what I wanted to say. So if I can add something for these first order phase transitions, what happens, for instance, in finite systems is that instead of having a constant slope here, you will have an intruder where the function, entropy function, will have in fact a convex part. Okay? But as you increase with the size of the system, this convex part will tend to disappear and will reduce more or less with the volume to the power -2/3 in three dimensions. So you have a surface effect which goes down as you increase the size of the system. This has been studied in numerical experiments. For instance, since I have the opportunity, I am in my office, I should recall the book on microcanonical thermodynamics by Dieter Gross, where there are a lot of examples of finite systems where you see this scaling of the surface contribution to the entropy. What happens with long-range interactions, and you will see in my lectures of tomorrow, is that instead this concave part of the entropy reaches a limit curve, and so remains non-concave. So giving perfect place to these sort of large deviations interpretation that you find in the review by Wotuschet, and also opening the way to the use of a Legendre Fenchel transform for systems with long range interaction. Okay, so if there are no questions, I think we are a few seconds before the end of the lecture. So I will not, I will conclude. So the thermodynamic limit of long range interactions is well defined, provided the interaction is rescaled using the Katz factor. Thermodynamics formulas can be adapted to allocate long-range interactions, but you should use the Legendre-Fenchel transform for non-concave functions. And you will see more explicitly in the next question that a feature of long-range interactions is that the entropy is a function of energy, but can be non-concave and giving a place to ensemble in equivalence and negative specific heat and all the features that we now know that are present in systems with long range interactions. So I conclude here and I will remain online. I stop sharing and we will meet in half an hour for the tutorial.
Okay, thanks, Stefano. So we'll see in meet in half an hour. Yeah. So.